record this to up. Oh, there we go. She's got it as I'm asking. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Welcome everyone to our second guest talk with Edul Daver. Edul is the past WZCC president, and I'll just hand it over to Edul to introduce himself, give a little background, and then maybe we'll be able to ask some questions.
Great. Maybe before that, can I just ask a question of the Wealth Club? What is exactly the objectives of the Wealth Club? Is it basically a way of generating high net worth in the long run? Is and you're talking about investments and entrepreneurship, or is that about the gist of it?
That's a great question. We're in the early processes of the Z Wealth Club, but our vision is to create a community of empowered young Zoroastrians in North America who can confidently make personal finance decisions. And we want to also provide younger individuals with accessible knowledge, resources, and potentially interactive workshops to enhance their understanding of personal finance. So the ultimate goal is to curate a group of professionals and amateurs to be able to combine the knowledge and spread it around, because that's what who we are as Zoroastrians. And I think it's a really amazing opportunity for us here, as we don't have a resource like this in North America.
Oh, by the way, I have designer hat too.
Very nice, very nice. Represent.
Okay. Well, just to give you a little bit of my background, I started in Secunderabad, India. I don't know how many people are aware of Secunderabad, Hyderabad. Went to school there up to the age of 10, after which went to a boarding school in Dehradun school in Dehradun. And that was when I really started developing, if you want to call myself, in the sense that I got an opportunity to play a very active part in all sports. It was a place where I think I started building confidence and character, you know, the discipline, the confidence and character. So I look at boarding school as a very effective, in my life at least, was a very, very powerful impact on me. From there, I was lucky enough to get into IIT Bombay directly, and I was good in math, so the idea was to get into engineering. By the time I finished school, I also enjoyed inorganic chemistry, so I took metallurgy as my major in IIT Bombay. My parents were very, very open-minded. They were very open to anything I wanted to do, and didn't really have too many constraints. When I would have a lot of my friends, parents would say, "Don't do this, don't do that," and for some reason, I was always allowed to do it. So, and their philosophy was, we'll provide you roots and then wings, and then you can do what you feel like, you know. While in college, basically, India was very, if you want to call it, at that point, had a socialistic bent, and with a lot of 5-year plans. And for some reason, I was a fish out of water. I was a little too capitalistic, if you want to call it, and I would argue with my professors, and they would say, "Who's this upstart trying to argue with us?" You know, and I can remember one incident where even Coca-Cola was not allowed to come into the country unless they gave the recipe or some, you know, it sounded like stupid to me, but anyway, so I had decided, I was, and I travel was something I really wanted to do, and I wasn't too sure I would be able to do that if I had a regular job in India. So by the time I was in a junior in college, I decided that I was going to go abroad. It was, you know, it, so I never really worked in India, and by the time the final year came, I already had admission at University of Wisconsin in Madison, and I literally left a month after the results were out. I left, and I think in May the results came out. In July I left, so I never worked in India. The only little work I did in India was during the summer. We would have to work at some place for 2 years while at IIT, and I'd worked at the Bhilai steel plant, which was a big, huge steel plant in India. Basically started with the help of Russian. It was a Russian-based set. So I worked for two sessions, 2 summers there. And really, in once I got to the University of Wisconsin, decision was, I did my master's very, very quickly. Within 9 months, I was done. And question was whether to start working or carry on for my PhD. Now, it so happened that I had a research assistantship. After I got there, I was able to get a research. And by the time I in 9 months, I said, this research is too slow for me. I need something with more action. So basically, the decision was, let me start working, perhaps get my MBA, and then I'll decide what I want to do. Just another background, though at that point I had no inkling about entrepreneurship. There was a lot of inspirational stories in my family about entrepreneurship. My grandfather from my mother's side had actually started the central bank at the age of 27. He was literally he sort of found out that the British who he was training would then end up with a salary which is literally 10 times the Indian's salary. And he was so felt so discriminated that at age 27 he went to his boss, a person by the name of young fellow or good fellow, one of them, and he said, I'm leaving. And they started laughing at him, and he said, what are you going to do? He said, I'm going to start a bank. So the laughter got even louder, and then he said, my bank is going to one day be bigger than your bank. So my mother would relate the story, so that was sort of subconsciously in my mind. My mother also started a school. She had a nursery school and a school which went up to. So my father was a doctor, and he was very professional. But there were, from my mother's side, there was some entrepreneurial DNA, if you want to call it. So after doing that master's, I literally had a job 3 months before graduating. So I've never really written a resume in my life. I got the job, and I went to work for Alcan Metal Powders in New Jersey. And basically, corporate progress was very rapid. But I then started thinking about entrepreneurship. And the first thought was, I've learned all this. And within 3 years, I had a pretty good handle on making, it was a metal powders plant to make metal powders. And we were making a trip, went had made a trip to India, and actually looked at starting a plant there. And my uncle, who was quite influential in India, said, look, raising money is no problem, but you're gonna have a bent of mind that you have to do things which are not absolutely above ground, sort of. And you have to pay off people, and you have to do this. And are you in that frame of mind? And the second thing he said was that a lot of the people who will give you money to build a plant, be very careful, because they very once they get the technology, they might discard you. So that obviously was not very good news. And my wife Nilufa said, we've just come to America. What do you want to go back to? So she wasn't that keen about it either. So we abandoned that first idea. Then I'd actually invested some money with a friend of mine who had a carbides plant in the Worcester, Boston. And for 2, 3 years, we had put quite a lot of money in it, and we were trying to grow it. But essentially, he was spinning his wheels. So, that didn't quite work out either. And then I was thinking of, while I was in Alcan, we used to buy a lot of specialty metal powders. And there were people who would just carry all these metal powders, like literally a warehouse of every single type of metal powder. And it's basically you buy it from some producers and then sell it to specialty people for research, for various things. So that was something on my mind. In the meantime, and by that time it was 1985, and the Alcan decided to getting rid of the downstream businesses. So boy, that was an opportunity that came, and I said, why should we wait for someone else to buy the company? Why don't we, why don't I put together management buyout and do it myself? So, no idea where the money would come from. Basically, between a few of us, we were had perhaps $200,000 that we could come up with. But the cost of the company was $12 million. And basically, what Alcan said is that we'll get a company evaluated, and that's what the evaluation came out at. If you agree to the evaluation, it's yours. If you don't, then we'll go to the open market and you can bid whatever you feel like. And so we didn't want to take the chance. We said, fine, 12 million is fine. We had no idea where the money was coming from. So they gave us 6 months and said, look, come, do it. And we went to about 30 different financial institutions. And until we finally, by trial and error, found out that we needed to go to asset-based financials, people like Congress Financial, GE Capital, and they were quite interested in it. And in the meantime, a lot of intermediary brokers became aware of it and said, oh, we'll get you the financing, we'll do this, but we want X percentage of your company, or you want X percentage of the amount that you sell for. So we said, well, let us try on our own. And we were able to do it without giving up any equity or giving any commission to anyone. So, we had a company, and which we called AccuPowder International. And the reason it was, it's A, capital C, small u. So it's initials of copper. CU is copper. So A, copper powder company. That's how it got its name. And basically, it was a break-even type of company. And a lot of people discouraged me in particular, that it's too much of a risk. One, because it was very marginal. We would have a very high debt load. We had environmental issues. It was a very old plant, so we had potential environmental issues. We had Steelworkers of America, which was a very confrontational union. So all the advice was, why are you getting into this? But I'd worked there. I knew it, and I knew what the opportunities were, that if we could basically build a motivated force and pay more attention to our customers, that we should be able to do it. So one of the key things that we introduced, we bought it. The first day, told all our employees that if we fail, we are all going to be without a job. If we succeed, you'll make more money than you ever did. And one way of doing that was, we said we're going to share 20% of our profits. We'll have a profit sharing plan, and we're going to share 20% of our profits with everyone. Now, that was an absolutely, if you want to call it, key action, which really completely changed the attitude of every worker. And this was over and above the union contract. People were so excited to part, and it wasn't a stock sharing plan where they would see the profit after 10 years or 20 years. It was every quarter. If you did well, and it was working very well. And then we came across something called open book management. There was a book by John Case called Open Book Management. And we were doing this intuitively. And this book actually described this very concept. But one thing we weren't doing is that we hadn't trained every employee on business. So we brought in a professor from outside who basically ran business courses on the site, and people were paid overtime to attend it. That means they would have an 8-hour shift, and then they would stay an hour or two and attend it. And essentially, we gave a 101 business course to every employee from the janitor up, so then they understood, and the entire focus of the company. People would come, when we'd have this quarterly meetings, they would say, we shipped more powders this last quarter, in pounds, but why'd we make less profit? And questions like that. And it was fun explaining it and getting them involved in it. They were literally, we Everyone felt like an owner. So I think that was actually a master stroke as far as I'm concerned. And I keep advising people, if you start a company, think about profit sharing. And as it's a very motivational tool if they understand how, how it's set up, how it's done. And you have to be o above ground. That means all our financials were open to everyone, except for salaries, everything was open. So that we ran the company for about 20, actually it's about 17 years. At that time we were all like over 65, age over 65, and we a private equity group came to us and said they would like to buy us. They had actually bought a similar company earlier, and this would be a roll-up. We would be the second. And now everyone was saying, why are you selling? After everyone saying, why are you buying? It was now, why are you selling? So anyway, we decided that it was time. It was a good price. And we would be all set for the rest of our retirement. At least money would not be an issue for after retirement. So we took the step and sold it. So that was sort of my, if you want to call it, entrepreneurial or business life. And while that was going on, in 2000, I involved in the formation of WZCC in Houston when it was formed. So I served on the WZCC board for 6 years from 2000 to 2006. So in 2010, basically we were looking at building a new Derrymere. So I sort of took the initiative and said, look, I think we can do it. And a lot of people said, the estimate was about $3 million. And he said, where are you gonna, who's gonna give it to you, or what, how's it gonna happen? And I said, let's try, and I think that is another entrepreneurial experience, if you want to call it. If you describe entrepreneurship as the pursuit of opportunity beyond resources available. So in the same way, we were trying to build this Derrymere where we didn't have the resources for it. And if I could spend an hour on explaining all the things that we did to make it happen, but that from 2010 to 2015, that was my focus. And we were successful in not only raising 3 million, we raised 5 million. We had a bigger Derrymere than we anticipated. Yeah. And, I think all of you are going to come next year, make a trip on the East Coast. So we're very happy to show you. Very proud and very happy to show you our Derrymere. And then in 2015, WZCC came, approached me and said, we'd like you to become the global president. And so from 2015, I went back to WZCC to become global president. And in 21, essentially, my 2 3-year terms are completed. So that was is basically my background. And I can answer any questions. And then if you want, I can go a little bit more into entrepreneurship and talk a little bit about entrepreneurship in a more generic fashion, you know.
That was amazing. Thank you so much for sharing that. I think a lot of us really resonated with some of the parts of your story. And I'd like to ask a couple specific questions about that. Specifically the profit sharing and the Finance 101 classes that you use to empower your employees. I really love that, and I would love to know a little more about how that process went. What the pros were, what the cons were. If you had to do it again, what would you change? And what was the most important part of it?
Yeah. Well, how did we come up with the 20% was sort of arbitrary. I looked around and basically we found one company in Boston area, Duck something. They have boats. I don't know if anyone's in
Duck
the
boats, the
Boston
Boston duck boats,
area.
yes.
Yeah, they had something similar to that. And I said, so basically I said, we're going to do 20% profit sharing. And then we actually, to make it a fun thing, I said, talk to your families. We want people to talk to them. And we said, if you can find another company which did more than 20%, we would give you a $100 a bonus for it, you know. So just 100, you know, sort of a game. And what we did was that 20% was divided into different components. That means that 20% would give you X number of dollars. Then we broke that up into four different categories. One was based on everyone getting equal. So 25% of that we would take and distribute it equally to everyone from the janitor to the president. The other 25% was based on length of service. The third 25% was based on departmental performance. And the last 25% was based on attendance. Okay. And this gradually evolved, and we changed our ratio where performance became more important. But one thing we didn't do, and I'm happy, was not we didn't do individual performance. We did basically departmental performance because it was 24-hour operation, multiple, you know, shifts. So we didn't want one shift trying to torpedo the other shift, show good numbers type of thing. So we wanted it to be complete departmental performance. And doing it for individuals, we did try to introduce that in a but a very discreet manner, because again, we didn't want to create a thing that why is he getting more or he getting less. Now, one of the big things we saw was obviously the union was far more cooperative. Okay. In fact, one incident I had where the union president came to me and said, "Oh, so and so Joe is sleeping on the third shift. You better have your supervisor watch him." The what is it? Yeah. So basically, I didn't want to do the individual because then the people start saying, "Why did so and so get more and why did I get less?" And it becomes too complicated. Yeah. The sending them to class, you know, we didn't do that the first 3 or 4 years. So again, if we hadn't done it, that would have been a big mistake. The challenge, to answer your question, what was the thing we would have to do, maybe take more trouble to do, is you have to keep focus on it so it doesn't become routine and it doesn't become something that they feel it's almost they're right, you know. So it's something to talk about constantly, maybe tinker around, change it constantly. So people are constantly talking about it, and it stays upper, you know, in upper mind. They're constantly thinking about it. So I can't think of any real negative of it. Obviously, you're sharing 20%, so you're reducing your profits. But I think you get back more than 20% in productivity gains on it. And the one thing that can become a problem is like if you at some point decide to eliminate it, it would be a major disincentive. So you have to be careful that once you start it, it's there constantly, you know.
I like that a lot. Definitely understanding what you're saying, and I like that you made that distinction. I'll do one last question and then open it up to anyone else. You said one of the things that you had to do was be very transparent with the financials and that process. How did that go when you did open up your books to employees? Were there certain things that you didn't realize that would come out? Were there negative effects to that? Because in my opinion, I'm very pro transparency. I think
Yeah.
the more transparency, the better. So I would just love to hear your thoughts on
Yeah.
that.
Yeah. The only thing we did not disclose were individual salaries. I mean, we would have a line, you know, salary line which shows total salaries, but we again didn't want to get into a situation of why does so much someone get this and so on again. But besides that, everything was open. Like, what is the cost of goods? What we spend on raw materials? What we spend on labor, electricity? You know, production supplies. Everything, and most of them, there's really nothing secretive about it. I don't see why people would hide it. I mean, the only number which people might want to hide is the profitability. But in our case, we said we were not going to do that. So, you know, we have it. So, and then we would calculate it. Now, also the way we distributed it so that whatever we earn in the first quarter, we would announce it but would not pay out anything. In the second quarter, we would take the 6 months' total earnings and pay out 50%. Third quarter, we would take 9 months' earnings minus what was already and paid 75% of it, but minus what was already paid in the second quarter. And then in the fourth quarter, we would pay the entire amount due. That is just in case the quarters coming afterwards were not going to be as good as the ones before. Okay. Now, the one challenge that no one asked that, but one of our biggest problems we had was in 2008 and 2009 when we had the recession. It was a very, very strong recession. And essentially, what we did is we went on a 4-day schedule. Basically, we told everyone, you know, we are reducing everyone's salaries by 20%. And you'll only work 4 days. Oh, sorry, you'll work 5 days. You'll work 5 days, but you'll get a 20% reduction in salary. Okay. But when we make money, you'll get back that 20% that we had held back. Okay. Now, if you didn't want that, you can work only 4 days and then you only get paid for the 4 days and you lost. But you get paid for 4 days, but work for actually 5 days, the full 40 hours. After the recession, when we make money, that lost money will be paid back. And the other deal we made with the union was, with the union, they always lay off the most senior persons first. They don't care about the junior most people. And he said, look, we shared in the good times altogether. We have to share in the bad times. So basically, we didn't lay off anyone, but they all took a reduction salary. And that was absolutely surprising that the union accepted that, you know. I mean, that it showed that that you know, mentally become, you know, part of management, if you want to call it.
That's awesome. Thank you for answering my questions. Those were great answers. I learned a lot. It looks like Kimia has her hand up, so we'll go to her. But if anyone wants to jump in after that, just feel free to talk.
Loved your story. Quick question on Saul's question because I was taking notes. So of the 20%, you mentioned one of the four parts was everyone got the same amount from the janitor to the CEO. And then the other one was the amount of years that they've stayed at the company. And then the next one was the performance maybe of the department or whatever category that you pick. And I didn't catch the fourth one. What was the fourth
Oh, it was
category?
attendance.
Attendance. Thank you so much.
Because we were very, you know, when people miss time, us being a continuous operation, we would have to hold people up on overtime, and there was a lot. I mean, you know, and the people were making very, very good salary. Like even a lower salary at that time was like literally close to $20 an hour, and mechanics would be making like 30, and by the time they got their overtime pay, I mean, they were all, you know, working in a labor force, but it wasn't unusual for the top mechanics and the people who are willing to work overtime to make close to $100,000 a year.
Yeah. And just from a psychological standpoint, this is like in a great way to reinforce and incentivize people. Like, it's just really well done.
I like the way you split it up a lot because my company does the same thing, but they do 1x for the operators, 2x for engineers, and 3x for supervisors. And I don't really like that division. I like how you split it up and there's legitimate reasons for each one.
Right.
But we'll go over to Farzine. It looks like
I
she
mean, we
has a
were
question.
very pay for performance type of thing. It was not unusual for what we call a master mechanic to make more than a supervisor. You know.
So I had a question. I really liked the idea of having business classes, so to speak, with like paid overtime. Did you find that that incentivized people to stay at the company and kind of use those skills at the position that they were currently in? Or did you see a lot of turnover because they were getting skills that they could use elsewhere?
Yeah. No, our retention rate was fantastic. If you were there for 20 years, you were considered sort of a junior person. Literally, our workforce was very immigrant oriented, if you want to call it. A lot of our production people were Portuguese, and a lot of our mechanics and electricians were Polish. And the reason was, once someone started, they would bring in their brother-in-law, they'll bring in the family people, and it just kept going. So we had a tremendous, and a lot of them didn't speak very good English. They had to speak a certain amount, but we didn't require a top class English speaking thing. And for the amount of money they were making, our turnover was extremely low. So, I don't think we lost anyone because of teaching them. They just took more interest in their work, and they felt very gratified. And we would have an annual, holiday party. And the most gratifying thing would be when the spouses would come to me and say, "Mr. Dawood, this is the best thing you ever did." That's all. Had a very good ring to it.
I love that.
Cyrus, whenever you're ready, I think we're ready for your
Sure.
question.
Thanks. Yeah, I've got a few questions. Some of it might just be details I missed. So I don't think I caught this. How did you get the financing for the 12 million? Where did that
Yeah,
come from?
basically it was asset-based financing. So we finally went with a company called IBJ Schroder, which is Industrial Bank of Japan Schroder, which was one of the smaller asset-based companies in New York City. And what they do is, the land was very high value. It was in New Jersey and had high value. So asset-based lenders will say, "Okay, we'll take, 75% of the value of the land, and we're willing to use that as collateral to give you X amount of dollars." Then we had inventory, which was very high value because we are in copper metal, and copper is almost like 80% the cost of the powder that we are actually going to make. The base is that much. So, and it's very sellable, resalable. The copper is copper in whatever form it is. So we could get, again, about 75, 80% of the value of our inventory. Then they come and value equipment, which they give you a certain amount of value, not very good. So they come up with have a formula, and they come up with a total and say, "Okay, here's so much collateral they have." And then we have to give a personal note. Two major partners, myself and our CFO, basically we had to give personal notes for what the bank called airball, which means that it's not covered, it's not collateralized, and they're just going. And James McConnell was our case manager. And one day he tells me, "Edul, we're giving you this big airball." Of course, we had to give a personal note, but for two reasons. He said, "One is, no one in their right mind is going to build a plant like that today." That's one question. One reason. And the second reason is because I like you. So the personal relationship is extremely important. And they know they're taking the personal note. If anything goes wrong, they're not really going to get the money from you. You don't have that much. But they don't want you to run away. They want you to work with them to get out of trouble if you get into trouble. So we had a personal note for the first 3 years. After that, we were able to convince them that the personal note is not needed, and it was canceled after that,
Okay.
So if you have assets, like someone, I met an entrepreneur who said he wanted to basically do something with a flying school, or, have a, and where would I, can I get the money? I said, "Look, if you've got airplanes, it's high asset value. People will give you money against it." So if you have assets available, could be intellectual property. In some cases, it could be intellectual property. So if you have assets, they're loaning money to you against those assets, and you're able to raise. If you go to a commercial bank, they laugh at you and say, "You don't have a balance sheet. No way you're going to get it."
Okay, so then when you took over the company, what changes did you make to the senior leadership and management teams, and then also to the culture? Like, did you try
Yeah,
to
well,
shift?
culture was very a big item. Essentially, you know, as I said, the profit sharing made them feel like part owners, and we did everything in teams. We basically made business, we call it, made it into a game, if you want to call it. We would have targets for everything, you know, and measure everything in production, equipment utilization, performance, productivity. So there are a lot of measures. And then every time we attained a objective, we would celebrate. Okay. For safety was a big item. No lost time accidents for 1 year. We would take them out to cruise around New York City. We would go to a Great Adventure Park. We would do things like that. And so basically, I see entrepreneurship as A, recognizing the opportunity, B, having a joint mission. So the mission or your objective is from bottom up, not someone just giving it to you. So you'd say, okay, here's a mission. And it was very important to us. Shareholder value didn't show up anywhere. You know, we'd call it stakeholder value. So it was customers, employees, and some social targets, you know. And then action-oriented. Speed was everything. You know, we would allow people to experiment very freely and make improvements. We got one of the changes was people were not afraid of making mistakes. In a corporate structure, half the time they don't do things because, you know, they just don't want to fail, sort of thing. So we were very open to that. We literally came up with new products constantly, but we did not patent anything, okay? Because we were too small for it. You know, you patent something, people see it, modify it, repatent it, then you have to spend a lot of money. So what we did is we kept an invention record, which means that if someone else comes out with the same a product or item, but if you have a record that you were actually using it before the date of the patent, you can still continue to use it. So we would do a lot of invention record keeping and then basically try to keep it confidential and do it that way. So there were a lot of innovative product development. We were the other thing with we were extremely flexible in taking products back if it didn't work. You would sell powders to a certain specification. Powder would meet specification completely, but the customer would say, for some reason, it's not working. You know, I'm getting too much shrink, I'm getting too much growth. And rather than forcing them to keep it, say, fine, no problem. We'll replace it, we'll take it back, give it back. Again, that was also a major thing. A lot of these parts were used into automotive applications, aircrafts. And if something went wrong, it also protected us from liability. And what are you spending taking it back? A little bit of freight coming back. We use the powder for someone else or reprocess it. So, and a lot of our competition didn't do that. They said, no, it needs spec. You have to do it. There's no way we're going to take your material. We'll take the material back. So again, that was our culture with the customers were very, very different. We had less turnover, so our salespeople had very good relationships with the customers. We had the same connection for years after year. They almost got to know their families, would go out to baseball games together, things like that. So we had an extremely good connection with them. There was one thing that I was going to say, and this is a change in what we did. Yeah, so customer service was important. Innovation was very important. That changed. I think those were some of the major items, and we called it the game of business. So we didn't take things or willing to accept fault. And basically, the climate was to enjoy work, to come in and feel that you want to work rather than being a 9-to-5 job, you know.
Okay, thank you. That's awesome. And then maybe the last question would be, how did the changes in the prices of metals, like the change in the price of copper, affect the
Yeah.
business?
Yeah, that could kill you. Okay, so that's very important. Everything we bought was hedged. We didn't gamble at all. Okay, so every ton of copper that we purchased was hedged. So we would, if the price went up, essentially you would, when you unhedge it, you lose the profitability on an upswing, but you also protect yourself in a downswing. So basically, we neutralize the effect of copper. So the way we would sell to our customer is copper plus. So basically, the only variable is what is the plus. The copper is whatever it is. So it could change on a daily basis. So he pays for the price of copper plus our conversion cost of converting into a powder. I know one company in particular which used to, if you want to call it, take the chances of making money as on copper, but they also would lose money and they actually went broke doing that.
Thank you.
Okay, it looks like we're nearing the end. Edul, I would love for you to give two
Harmito's
to.
hands up. Wait, Harmito's
Oh,
hands.
I didn't see it. Sorry, my bad. Go for it.
Yeah, nice talk, and I really enjoyed it. I didn't get that. Which age did you start your company? I think you started in the old age. And as I heard that usually with getting age, it's getting more risky and you don't like to have this type of risk. How did you handle with that?
Well, I try, as I said, the interest was there, and we tried a couple of times to do different things. So, and those were okay, but wasn't a winner, if you want to call it. So, one of the things is what you try the first time doesn't work, try something different, second, try third time, sooner it will work. Yeah, we basically, and it worked out actually quite well because. We started in 85, so and I was born in 44, so so we were in our 40s, late 40s, if you want to call it. And what happened was that after we actually bought it, there were a couple of years that we weren't quite in owners of it yet because, as I said, there were some environmental issues, and by New Jersey state law. Alcan was required to get a clean it up and have a no further action. So Alcan said, we'd rather do that upfront rather than after we've sold it. So there was almost like a 4 or 5 period where we were pretty much running the place independently, but technically we were still part of Alcan, So it's never too late to be an entrepreneur, to answer your question. There's a couple in New Jersey, Dunn and Phil Schroff. They are involved in fancy clothing they bring in from India, and they literally started after they retired. So they started at age 65, said, and they're right now in their close to 90 years old, and they're still active. So you can be an entrepreneur at
Yeah,
any age.
definitely. Thank you.
So the one thing I would advise is that it doesn't hurt to be a specialist in your field. So sometimes it's better to work with a company for 2 or 3 years, learn the ropes, if you want to call it. Also make contacts with potential customers. So depending on what your field is, but having a network of people, contacts is very important in any business. So I would say don't necessarily, if you're can again do what your inner body heart tells you to do, but from a rational point of view, work for someone, get a little bit of experience, then go out on your own, especially if you're doing it in that field. It'll cut down your it'll accelerate your chances of succeeding and growing. And reduce your risks appreciably. The other thing is, risk is don't look at it as a bad thing. If you gamble, that means you don't know what you're doing and you're just saying, okay, I'm going to, that's bad. But if there's a risk and a calculated risk, there's nothing wrong in it. And you almost have to do it if you're going to be an entrepreneur. So you can't be afraid of it.
I like that quote. I think we'll have to grab that as a quote for the
Yeah.
meeting.
And an example I often use is that if you want to cross a road and you go blindfolded across the road, that's gambling. Okay, if you look to the right, look to the left, and go across the road, that's a calculated risk. You could still get hit by a car, but that's it's a
That's
calculated risk.
a good one. So can I
Whenever,
jump in? Two quick.
whenever you're ready. I was waiting for
yeah, so
you.
for my, just from my point of view, this is what I've been trying to promote with WZCC, for people to think about it. It's not meant, everyone may not want to be an entrepreneur, but at least think about it, consider it, and if it's something that makes sense to you, definitely pursue it. We'll try and help you in any way possible, and we've essentially, as an offshoot of WZCC, we formed ZF, which is the Zoroastrian Entrepreneurship Development Foundation, where we've collected donors' money. We've collected over $300,000 at this point, and our target is to collect $1 million. And then we would give loans of $50,000 to individual entrepreneurs, which have to be paid back in about 4 years, but without interest. So it's something we've done four loans. One fifth one we just approved, so it'll be the fifth one. But obviously, it has to be something where it's more than just an idea, and you have a little bit of track record and have something to show, cash flow to show for a short time, to sort of, because it's donated money, so we can't again take undue gamble on it. We have to take a calculated risk. And we would love to get more applicants. Actually, I'm a little bit surprised at the rate at which the applications are coming out. Is at a lower rate than what we expected, The cap that you saw, that was like one of the people that we've given the money to. And I think some of you went to the restaurant in Berkeley, California. That was the second one that we've given money to. And the third one is a hair salon. A lady has an upscale hair salon in late Las Vegas. And there's a food supplement person in Los Angeles. And the fifth person is actually a company called Genome. It's Avastajan is the company in India, but they are doing really cutting edge research in identifying DNA and stuff like that. It's sort of pretty high tech, which we don't understand completely, but they are on the cutting edge of it, and they need money to really move from India to the US, where all the activity is going on here.
That's awesome, Edul. I love that. As we're kind of coming close to the end here, we got about 8 more minutes. Kimya, if you want to ask your questions, and potentially these could be the last questions if no one else has anything.
Sounds good. My questions are probably quick. One question, if you feel comfortable sharing, how much did you sell your company? And the second question is, with venture capital or when you get money from other people, usually there's a lot of stigma that, they become your boss and they can get mean or like put a lot of pressure on you or tell you to go in a different direction or maybe compromise on some of your ethics. It seems like you kind of had a smooth experience with your like money that you got. So just
No, we have really what we sold for the company is sort of a confidential number, but we do tell people that when you're selling, EBITDA is a very important number, earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization. And depending on the business, you would sell your business for anything between a multiple of 3 to a multiple of 15. About multiple of 7 is probably the most common multiple, you know, which so we got a good multiple. And as far as what is the second part of it you said?
The money that you venture
so what
capital.
We're giving is we're not controlling them at all. You know, we give them a free hand. If they want need advice, we've got a group of 7 people, which is the business advisory
committee. sorry, not that part. I mean, when your company got money for the rest of the 12 million, was there any pressure from the people that gave you the money for how you operate your company, or you felt like they stayed?
They were not equity investors. Okay. So they were strictly so as long as you paid your loan regularly, if you they didn't get involved, we would give them a report, and they might make some casual comments, but in general they were very, very complimentary of what we were doing, except in 2008 and 2009. And very luckily, and that's funny, the banks, when you're having trouble, that's when you need the help, but that's when they give you the least help. But luckily what happened is that the bad months were the 6 months of 2008, the latter part, and then the other 6 months fell into 2009. So it wasn't one complete bad year. So in both years, we were like break even or very slight loss. Wasn't really major. But if everything had fallen into 1 year, our numbers would have looked terrible. And then they'd start putting, you know, restrictions the rate can go up, and a lot of things, bad things can happen. So, you know, if you can afford to pay back the loan, obviously pay it back as quickly as you can. You know. We never completely paid back our loan because we would need new material for capital improvements and things like that. So a substantial amount was paid, but even after so many years, there was a certain amount of loan that existed. And I think if you want to keep up with improvements, you have to. You can't say, I'm going to balance my books and not going to take any loan. I mean, you can do that depending on what you are. But in most cases, if you want to stay ahead of the curve, you almost have to have some borrowing that allows you to be ahead of competition, so to speak, you know.
I got you. Thank you for explaining. With percentage-wise, I know home loans. But like, what is the percentage of interest you pay on, for example, a business loan? And I know, for example, we're very lucky in the U.S. to have 30-year fixed loans. But as soon as you go into commercial, it's not 30 years fixed. There's balloon payments. So what's it like in the business world?
Yeah. Now, again, I don't know what the current rates are, but you would have either a ratio with prime. That means X 2% over prime, 2.5% over prime. Or you could have a LIBOR-based loan. Which is the London Exchange, and you would have LIBOR plus X percent, you know. So the rates were quite reasonable, you know. We were paying industrial type loan. So at one point, LIBOR was like, you know, below like 2%, 1.5%. So you were paying like 4% type of loan. So it wasn't as bad as. You might take a commercial loan, which could be higher. So actually, our rates for asset-based lending were more attractive than a commercial rates.
That's awesome. Thanks for sharing.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah, and another thing is if you did very, very badly, they could then say that they would want part of the equity. You know, so that could be another complication. If you do badly, they suddenly start taking. And if you do very badly, then they put you into receivership and someone takes over, and then you get involved in day-to-day management, you know. But luckily, we didn't face anything like that.
Super exciting. Thank you so much for your time, Edul. Does anyone have any last questions before we say thank you and goodbye? Awesome.
So well, thank you. Please do consider taking part in WCC activities. And as we talked, some way of piggybacking each other's activities, it'll be great. Because one of the big issues we're having, or what we would like to improve, is increased youth participation. You know, and your group, how big is your group or current?
Somewhere between 80 and 100 people, I believe.
So, you know, if we could have periodic sessions together, you come to us. Now, at some point in Los Angeles, I don't know if anyone attended the Los Angeles Youth Congress, but we had done a Shark Tank type of event, which we call Tiger's Den. And we are hoping we can do it at the upcoming AGM in Pune in January. But where we would have a group of people soliciting money in exchange for equity, and a group of investors who hear the thing and are willing to, just like Shark Tank, you know, basically. And it was a real fun event in Los Angeles. It was absolutely great.
That's awesome. I definitely think there's opportunities for collaboration with what we have and what you guys have built. And Edul, if you'd like to send any more information through email on that previous email chain, by all means, we're here for it and we're really excited. Thank you so much for spending this hour with us. I think it was super educational for 100% me, and I'm sure everyone else found something to take out of it. I really liked you talking. I didn't realize that a lot of your business was manufacturing, and everything you said, I can literally visualize to my work every day. So I love chatting with you, and I look forward to talking in the future. Thank you.
Wonderful. Yeah. And by the way, the questions were extremely pertinent and to the point. Appreciate them and congratulate you on that. And I enjoyed it very much too. Yeah.
Thank you so much for being here with us. Thank you. Okay. Have a great rest of your day.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for also joining and participating.